I'm not gonna provide basic and boring knowledge that you might have heard a million times about. Instead, what I'm going to do, I'm going to be 100% transparent with you, because when you build a remote team, when you try to build a remote team of your own, everybody is telling you about perks you should provide for your team members, about different benefits, about daily meetings and keeping on track with everything that's going on inside the team, which is all relatable, but that is not showing the biggest struggle that you will face with when you build and maintain a remote team. Hey Top Gun, welcome to the channel for work at home professionals and IT entrepreneurs. I'm Olga, I'm your host, and I'd appreciate your support. Like, subscribe, bell icon, comment below. Let's begin. Secret number one, hire the right type to start with, to not get disappointed later along the way. As a remote entrepreneur, when you hire a remote team member, remote team members, and you build a remote team, you want to hire the best talents for your team, right? Now the question is, why would the best talents go and work for you, rather than working for Microsoft or Google or Amazon or other big tech companies? You definitely cannot outbeat the offerings of those bigger companies on the benefits, on sweet perks and corporate culture. So how can you attract those best talents to your team? In other words, why would those best talents prefer you and your small team rather than your direct clients and your direct competitors? The secret is, choose and hire the right type. Pay attention to the personality of the team member that you're about to hire, and not only their hard and soft skills. And what I mean here is that you should be a reader of the human heart, if you will, a thought reader, so that you can understand what type of person is actually sitting before you. Of course, you cannot provide, the fact is that you cannot provide perks and benefits of the bigger company and the corporate culture that they have and any other benefits that they might attract their candidates with. What you can provide though is 100% remote work, which is vital for many, family-like, friendly, welcoming, warm team, and whatever tiny benefits and tiny perks that you can provide. A vacation maybe, or an unlimited access to some educational platform, whatever it may be, and whatever you can actually provide to your team members. Now think, who might be interested in joining your team on such terms, on tiny benefits and remote work? So remote work is not for everyone, but think about it. Who, what type of a person might prefer to work in your team rather than in a bigger company and for your direct clients? From my experience, I distinguished two types of such people, such candidates, who would prefer your team rather than anyone else. The first type is super talented interns who are willing to do the job, who are able to do the job, that's important, and who are burning with the desire of improving, of learning new skills and get that experience. Maybe later on they will move to the next company, to a bigger company, but as is, they are willing to do the job, they are willing to get experience, they can do the job, they can prove that they are the right candidate. So do hire this talent and they will prove you right. Of course, you should be 100% sure that they can do the job under some supervision, but if you have chosen right, if you have checked their hard skills, their soft skills, and their personality type, that might be a way out for you. The second type is super experienced senior professionals who are not easily impressed by any corporate perks that other companies might provide. They have seen it all. They've been maybe to Google, to Microsoft, they worked in bigger companies. They have seen it all. They rose to the upper stage of the corporate ladder, and they are engineers, you know, it's a state of mind. They don't want to go further and become managers or start their company. They want to remain engineers and they are senior. They don't need any supervision, but what they want is to do the job and get paid and be left alone. In my team, these two types proved to be the most consistent throughout the years, and these are just the types who are, again, not easily impressed by any corporate rubbish, by any motivational speeches, by any enthusiastic, you know, promises and so on. maybe team building activities that they hate and crowded office spaces. They just want to do the job, get paid, and they want a quiet, remote workplace to work in, and this is something that you can well provide. Operate with whatever perks you can have. 100% remote work is vital for many, you'd be surprised. The secret too is set clear requirements and clear procedures. In fact, you should have done so when outlining a job description, when seeking for the candidate. But if you still haven't, do that now. Because when you hire a remote employee, that means that you hire a certain type of personality, maybe some introvert, who wants to make it all clear and who wants to make the best of their time. And you know, when you work with a remote team, it's very important that everybody has something to do for the day. So when you set your clear expectations of what you expect that person to do, you make them busy and they don't have, you know, any time to think about, oh, maybe I did wrong by joining this team, maybe I should try to find something better. When a person has something to do, when they have clear expectations, clear requirements, and clear to-do list for the day, they have less such thoughts. I would recommend you having those requirements and expectations and duties written in a written form so that everybody could have an access to that whenever, you know, some sort of an issue arises. And not only those should be requirements and duties and expectations, but also rules of communication with the customers. If you work in a service-based company, in an outsourcing company, if you have an outsourcing team, that's very important that you have clear rules of communication with the customer. I would even recommend having a separate meeting on that one, because communication of your hired developer, engineer, employee with the customer, the wrong type of communication, might ruin your entire project. Check out that video of mine where I talk in more details about particular situations that can actually lead to the ruination of your project. Now, the secret three is something that I have already mentioned in the beginning of the video, and that is have daily meetings with your video on. That is important because, you know, personal interaction and personal appearance, that actually matters, and that helps to bind you together, to make you understand each other better, because not all the time you can understand what the person is actually thinking about by just hearing their voice. You should see their facial expression. So I would strongly recommend having your video on. And yes, I said daily meetings. If you work based on Scrum model of project delivery, that is easier done. Have daily stand-ups where everybody is telling you what they have done and what they are about to do, and ask questions. So like 5 to 10 minutes, depending on the size of your remote team, would do, so that you could address each other's needs, so that people would feel that they're actually being important to you and what they do is valuable. Again, when you work in a Scrum and if you have retrospectives, if you don't have, do have retrospective meetings where you will discuss not only professional achievements and not only ups and downs on the project, you know, what we have done right and what we have done wrong. Do recognize personal achievements of the team members. Like literally ask, John, how is your hobby? How is your success, I don't know, with skydiving or whatever hobbies they have? And put those recognitions and those achievements again in that retrospective document, so that everybody is feeling like they are working with the leaf people and not with, you know, coding robots. And important thing is also recognize their downs, because when a person is, you know, suppressed or depressed or there's something bothering them, don't ignore. Approach that and try to find out if you can help, or at least provide, you know, free ears so that the person could share their troubles with you, and maybe it will, you know, ease their burden. And again, the better that person will feel, the better they will perform. That's natural. Secret number four, and that comes as a surprise to some of the managers who manage a remote team, but as an owner of a remote team, you should not repeat that mistakes, and that is, don't treat your remote employees as you would your office workers. Allow some flexibility. Don't treat your employees as your office workers. This is probably the reason they have gone remote, or they are looking for remote opportunities, or they have joined your remote team. They want some flexibility and they don't want to be treated as 9-to-5 galley slaves. Or probably they just can't work fixed hours. Whatever reason it might be, they might have, you know, family to care for, or whatever reason they have, if they still can't perform the job and do the job on the appropriate level, for God's sake, leave your people alone and let them work whatever hours they need. Of course, you can just pick certain hours when you have like daily scrum meetings or meetings with the customer or your some team meetings and team activities. So bespeak that set hours when they have to be online, when they have to attend those meetings and they have to be at their workplace. But other than that, when they do the tasks, when they do the projects, when they deliver results, I personally don't care when my employees are working at night, in the evening, in the morning. I am online 24/7, so I can answer, I'm approachable each time of the day, and I actually don't care when my people are. Unless the project is suffering, I don't care. Secret number five, and some might hate it, but that is offline activities, offline meetups, or if not possible, non-work related virtual activities. Now, offline is important to meet in person, to maybe make friends with your coworkers, actually make friends and not just work together, and you know, spend time with them and communicate, you know, in person on non-work related activities. And if your coworkers find some common language on some other topics rather than work, they might be better performing together when working on a project because they actually started to like each other and they don't want to let each other down. If you can arrange an offline meetup of your remote team members once a year, that is perfect. Some run away from the city or maybe going to vacation together. If this is not possible, think about alternatives. Think about what virtual activities you can have together. For example, some online games where you can work together as a team would do, you know, but that depends on the preferences of your team members. Some like RPG games, some like shooters, some like action games. But then you can find some alternative that everybody enjoys. That can, of course, that can, should be greetings with birthdays, with holidays, wishing well for vacations, and weekly mail out to your remote team members. For example, on Friday, you can do a Friday mail out congratulating your team members with another successful, you know, week. And not only successful, if there were any troubles, if there were any issues, you should address those issues and never ignore, you know, don't be that type of woohoo leader who only recognizes success. Face with struggles that your team members are having too. So be a person to whom they can come and tell you what is bothering them, because the rule six, or the secret six, is part your ways as friends. Yeah, part friends. Preserve good relationships with your team members if they decide to leave your team. It's never easy, especially if you put in a lot of effort, you know, to make that team member part of your team. Especially that is the case with interns, when you put such a lot of effort into them and they decide to leave you. But then there is nothing you can do if a person really decided to leave your team. So my advice is part friends. Wish them well, say that you understand and that you're there for them if they need anything. Because the ugly truth is, if you both stay in the same industry, huge chances are that you will meet again or that you might need each other again. And my advice is, do part friends, because again, huge chances are that you will meet together again. I have seen a lot of mistakes being done when separating with the employees. Check out this video of mine where I talk about tech entrepreneurs who started their teams and had troubles with the soft skills and communication within the team. With that said, hit all the buttons you find below, say something nice to me in the comments, grab all the freebies that you might find in the description box below, put these practices to a good use, and very best of luck to you, Top Gun. See you next Wednesday, as usual. Bye.